Honorable Chairperson and jury members and all other participants, a very good evening. Myself, Shivalakshmi Armugam, I'm doing my PhD in criminology. My topic is mainly about the detection of child sexual abuse material with the perspective of preventing it from the policing angle. This is an ongoing project. I did a systematic review of literature on what are the investigation tools and techniques that are in practice worldwide. I have not restricted it to one country, but worldwide, what are the various investigation tools and techniques that are being used in these cases. So to begin with, what is meant by child sexual abuse materials is nothing but what is commonly known as child pornography. So in India, except watching an adult pornography in a personal device just on our own, apart from that, all other activities involving adult pornography or child pornography are considered as a criminal offense. Which means any type of engagement with pornography, viewing, sharing, producing, downloading, browsing, or even trying to search for it, or seeking it, asking for it, buying it. So all the various types of involvement with the material is considered an offense, is considered as an offense. Since 2019, we have certain provisions that are being brought in which criminalizes the child pornography materials. With respect to that, IT Act and POPSO has been amended, which you can see in the in this one, section 67B of the IT Act, and then section 13, 14 subsection 1 and 15 subsection 1, 2 and 3 of POPSO Act collectively has criminalized the creating, collecting, possessing, storing, seeking, browsing, and etc. All these behaviors with respect to the involvement of children in a pornography as a criminal offense. So this particular act is very, very special because it is not only recognizing the use of children in the pornography, but also the depiction of children. So for example, even if an adult is dressed up like a child, then still it is coming under the, it can still be tagged as child pornography and it is a punishable act. Or even if a child's face has been distorted, that the child's identification cannot be found. Still, it is a depiction of a child in a sexual context. So all these types of activities have been criminalized recently. So my interest was in finding out how the police are now trying to investigate these type of cases. How are they detecting it? So or what are some of the proactive approaches in the policing? So for this, I started with a review of literature. So I did a systematic review in which resources like Google Scholar, EBSCO, Science Direct, and every other libraries that my university, Coronia Institute of Technology and Sciences, have access to, subscribe to, I have used that. And the four main keywords that I have used in to collect the materials are child pornography detection, CSAM investigation, policing child pornography, and CSAM forensic tool. So before going into this, I need to tell why I'm using the term CSAM and but not child pornography. Even though the law is using the term child pornography, as a researcher, I do not want to use that word because the word pornography, just like photography, is considered as an art of taking pictures, an art of capturing a moment. Pornography is an art of sexualizing an activity. It's an art of nudity. So when a child is being involved, we should not be calling it as an art. It is an abusive material. Therefore, instead of using the term child pornography, I prefer to use child sexual abuse material. Some researchers also use child sexual exploitation material. However, the word abuse has a more serious connotation than the exploitation. So now moving on to the literature that I have got. I have, after doing the inclusion and exclusion criteria in my research, I found out that there are four books and 21 articles that are identified to discuss about the investigation methods or the forensic tools, and both, in some cases both. So the review is still under process. Some of the inclusion criteria that I used are, I wanted to find out the researchers that in that are within the 10 years, the past 10 years from 2010 to 2021. And also I was looking for researchers that have specifically developed a tool and has implemented to some extent. Therefore, we can understand the effectiveness of the tool. So those were some of the inclusion criteria. And in exclusion criteria, I have especially made reference to articles that only talks about designing a tool, the articles that are only giving out an idea, but it's not particularly developed or being considered in any development in any of the major companies like Microsoft or Google, etc. So the articles that were talking only about the design aspect, I have excluded it. Okay. Then some of the major findings that I have found are of two types. First, I found out that in the investigation techniques, the police are using covert operations or undercover operations. There are two types how they are using these techniques in the digital spaces. So they are creating a profile on their own to act as a child or to act as a pedophile. So pedophile are the people who have excessive sexual interest in children. So they are into child grooming, they are into abusing, sexually abusing, they are into watching a lot of content that sexualizes children, so etc. So they are posing as these two different entities in order to find out the offenders online. So those who are trying to have a sexual conversation with a child, immediately they are taking that evidence and trying to find the offender. So this is one way. And the other way is acting as a pedophile. So creating a profile on themselves where they are showing that that person with that profile has interest in the sexual interest in the children, so that the people, the other pedophile, will be contacting them. So this is basically it is basically depending on the research where it is found that most of the pedophiles come together, form a network, they share the materials with each other. They not only just share the materials, they also share ideas on how to abuse, sexually abuse a child without getting caught. So how can they be more stealthy with their grooming process of a child online? So they form a network and then they share materials and ideas related to their criminal activity. So therefore, when police are involving as one among them, they will be able to find evidences and people whom they can apprehend later. So these were the two main covert operations that are being done by police online. And then I have found many tools, forensic tools that are used by the law enforcement, Interpol and other law enforcement officials in various countries. So the three main things that I would like to discuss today is one done by the NCMEC, National Center for Missing and Exploited Children tool. So this is basically an international NGO that comes under Missing Children NGO based out of the US. So this is one of the, they are one of the pioneers in this aspect. They have connection with the Interpol, and along with the Interpol, they whatever information that they have gathered, they will pass on to the law enforcement in different countries all over the world. So recently, right after having this amendments in the law, now in India, we have NCRB, National Crime Records Bureau, acting as a central agency to collect this information and then distribute the information to the respective state law enforcement. So that is being done by the NCRB in India. So they are the main contact point because they are having a tool which can detect, which can identify people in various platforms, using various platforms, Facebook, all the social media networks, in some dark web, dark websites, in peer-to-peer networks, etc. So they actually use tools like text analysis, facial recognition, the sentiment analysis. So using all these techniques, they are trying to find the potential offenders as well as the offenders themselves, and then distributing their IP addresses to the respective countries for further prosecution. So in this particular tool, there was one researcher who were who was involved in an observation study. She found out that in 2018, she found that the way they are trying to identify the victims and offender in a known material is very racist in approach, which means the algorithm that is using to find out the victim and the offender, it is trying to focus on the victims or white skin tone, and then the offenders are black in skin tone. And the reason why this tool has been considered racist is because the tool that was developed and has been working on the offline information previously. So from that, it is learning how an offender would look like, how a victim would look like. This is one of the major disadvantage of this tool, where it is where the machine is learning on its own, the and defining who is, who could be the offender, who could be the victim. And another research, new detective or nudity detective, in was developed in Brazil, and they have kept it free for the law enforcement and for also academicians who are focusing on this in this research. So in this, it has been found that the law enforcement officials who have used this tool has reported that this tool is best in finding, filtering out the non-child sexual abuse material, which means a child would be nude or you know, partially nude in some images or in videos. For example, if a child is wearing undergarments in a beach, having fun with the family, then this is not a child sexual abuse material. It's simply a child having fun in on a holiday. So this is this algorithm used by the new detective is very much focused on finding the child nudity in a very sexual context only. So that is one of the advantage of the new detective. And the third one, which I would like to mention, is that the law enforcement are using this particular alert system called Predator and Prey Alert, where they try to find the potential victims. So for example, even in the dark web, using text analysis in the advertisements, particularly sexual trafficking advertisements, the advertisements are something not related to the sex work. It will be considered suspicious. So the numbers, the location, those information are taken, and they try to find through other information whether this is, these are some of the identifying information of a victim or not. If those were the potential victims, then using this system, they try to send the alert on how to escape from there or to not fall as a prey for further crime. So these were some of the tools used in the prevention of sexual abuse material too. So from the research, what I understood was that not a lot of tools have been developed to find out detecting these materials in a peer-to-peer network, because most of the thing are focused on the surface internet. And even in the dark web, or the use of the Onion router, there are other difficulties in finding out the host and the seeker of a particular service. That is mainly because the constant change in the IP addresses in the system. However, there was one specific research made in China, where they were sending out a Tor protocol to a suspicious Tor hosting website. And when a TOR protocol is being sent, and then the particular host is responding to a TOR protocol, they are able to identify that this is a device that is working on TOR. So this is not based on the IP addresses, but it is based on the communication that is specifically used for TOR. So these are some of my findings, but researchers on TOR, finding out the TOR request or peer-to-peer networks, and also the encrypted messaging services like WhatsApp, Telegram are still a major challenge where the law enforcement could not break in and identify the materials or the offender or the victim. Thank you so much.